Chair have yet to be elected. In my role as committee clerk, I will call the meeting to order. So before we get into the agenda, I'd like to provide a very short protocol for electronic meeting participation. Recorded votes are not allowed at committee meetings. The committee chair or I will call for any objections. If you have an objection, please unmute your microphone and indicate your name and objection. If no objections are stated, the motion will be deemed to be approved. Members participating electronically that need to leave the meeting, please send an email to council@peelregion.ca. If you leave the meeting, you will be marked absent for any votes thereafter. If you would like to request to speak, please raise your hand in WebEx or send an email to council@peelregion.ca. For a full view of presentations, please select the focus or stage layout view. We shall now commence the meeting with roll call. Citizen Member Fairhead.
Present.
Thank you. Councillor Fonseca.
Here. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you. Councillor Raz is absent due to a personal matter. Regional Chair Yanika is present in chambers. Councillor Santos.
Present.
Thank you. Councillor Sinclair. Councillor Sinclair. Councillor Starr.
Present.
Thank you. And Citizen Member Zuberi.
Present.
Thank you.
Hi there. And did I get bounced off this committee?
Councillor Dasko, yes. At the midterm election, we did pass a motion. But you're more than welcome to stay.
No, I've got enough on my plate to keep me busy. So be well.
Okay, enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you. Okay, so the first order of business on today's agenda is the election of chair and vice chair. I would like to provide a very brief high-level overview of the process. So each nomination shall be moved by a member. Each mover may speak to the motion for nomination should they wish. After nominations have closed, each nominee may, prior to the vote being taken, speak to the motion for nomination. A nominee may withdraw his or her name at any time. And if there is more than one nominee for the position of chair or vice chair, a vote will be taken and the nominee who receives the majority of votes will be elected. Are there any nominations for chair of the Audit and Risk Committee?
No. Madam Clerk, it's my hand is raised. Yes, I would like to nominate Councillor Starr as chair.
Thank you. Councillor Starr.
We're just doing chair right now? Yes.
Yes, just chair right now. Okay, and Councillor Starr, do you accept the nomination?
I do.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other nominations for chair of the Audit and Risk Committee? Okay, hearing none, we will now close the nominations. Are there any objections to closing the nominations? Hearing none, the nominations are now closed. So I do have a motion before me that states that Councillor Starr be elected as chair of the Audit and Risk Committee for the remainder of the council term or until a successor is appointed. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. Okay, now moving over to vice chair. Do we have any nominations for vice chair of the Audit and Risk Committee? Councillor Fonseca, you're on the board.
Yes, thank you, Madam Clerk. I would like to nominate Councillor Santos as vice chair.
Thank you. Councillor Santos, do you accept the nomination?
Thank you, and yes.
Perfect. Are there any other nominations for vice chair of the Audit and Risk Committee? Okay, hearing none, we will now close the nominations. Are there any objections to close the nominations? Hearing no objections, the nominations are now closed. So I do have a motion before me that states that Councillor Santos be elected as vice chair of the Audit and Risk Committee for the remainder of the council term or until a successor is appointed. Any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. I would like to turn the meeting over to Councillor Starr, who will preside for the remainder. Thank you.
Thank you. And welcome, everyone. I think when we were just talking the preamble, this is officially day 310 of COVID-19. So there you go. There's your trivia today. And welcome and Happy New Year to everybody. The first item is item number three, declarations of conflict of interest. Hearing none, we'll move on to the approval of the agenda. Any changes, additions, comments? Move, okay, we'll move by Councillor Fonseca. All those in favor? Hearing no objections, approved. And we'll move on to item number five. There are no delegations. And we'll move into the reports. 6.1 is the first item, is IT application portfolio sustainment. And it looks like we have a trifecta of presenters, Sean, Peter, and David. You take us, I'm not sure who's leading off here. David?
Or? Good morning. Yeah, good morning, Mr. Chair. I'm going to ask Peter Parson, our Director of IT Solutions, to step in and lead us through the presentation. So over to you, Peter.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Can I just confirm that you can hear me okay? Perfect. Thank you. So thank you for inviting us to present today. We're here as a follow-up request to a report on security assessment, which was presented here at Audit and Risk Committee. In September of last year. At that time, the application portfolio was referenced during that presentation, and further information was requested. Next slide, please. So today's presentation will outline the concept of technical debt, how it applies to the region of Peel, the framework we have in place currently and proposed to address this, the work that we've done so far, as well as our planned approach moving forward over the next 3 years. Next slide, please. So the concept of technical debt, which we'll refer to, in its initial sense was, for reference sake, was used by code developers or software developers to describe the extent of rework required when they were writing code. Over the last several years, however, the term has actually been expanded and is now used in reference to the remediation effort required to address old and outdated systems. One of the impacts of old and outdated systems is that defect work or break fix work, as it's referred to, really outweighs value added feature work. Next slide, please. So some of the implications of old and outdated systems and technical debt are the fact include the fact that outdated technologies often become unsupported, thereby really creating a risk to the organization. There's often an inability to improve inefficient processes. Integrations of new systems are either more complex and expensive or in fact may not be feasible. And as you look for people to support your outdated systems, there's often an increased reliance on expensive outside contractors as staff leave to work on new technologies. For reference, Gartner indicates that over 8 in 10 respondents to a UK survey, so almost 84%, did not have an active tech or debt reduction program in place. Next slide, please. So a different view or perspective on technical debt just shows here from McKinsey that roughly 20% of respondents to this survey spend less than 5% allocated to paying down technical debt. And really, in terms of good practice, only about 10% have a budget allocation ongoing of over 20% allocated to paying down their technical debt. Next slide, please. So here I'd like to talk about and provide the committee an overview of our approach here at Peel to technical debt management. So there's a four-phased approach or four-stage approach, starting with establishing a platform strategy. So in 2015, the region of Peel embarked on the establishment of a platform strategy. Since then, we have four of our enterprise platforms in place, including Microsoft, Salesforce, and currently we have two enterprise platforms on the deck, started or in progress, which includes our ERP and our EAM platforms. In addition, we developed and implemented technology standards as a policy and as a requirement for all new implementations. Secondly, in 2018, there was an initiative launched to identify and assess our application portfolio, prioritizing immediate technical debt items that required remediation. And I will provide some further information on that in some subsequent slides. And then along with that is an approach to actually reduce or address the most immediate technical debt, which includes modernizing legacy apps. And then prospectively looking forward, we are looking to align with the corporate asset management program and establish a steady state. Next slide, please. So to give context to the amount of applications within the region of Peel IT portfolio, there's approximately 1,700 supported applications in use across the region. About 350 of those are what you would consider your traditional type applications that rely on on-premise infrastructure. But as technology moves more towards a cloud-based solutions, we have seen an increase in our cloud-based applications, and we anticipate that we will continue to see that that increase. So there's approximately 150 cloud-based applications in our portfolio. And then there are smaller standalone applications, desktop applications, which would not be considered enterprise in nature and are used at a departmental level or at an individual level, and there's approximately 1,200 of those. Next slide, please. So in 2018, we engaged an external party to work with us to review our on-premise enterprise applications, and we looked at a total of 250 applications at the time and prioritized the top 44 of those. And those were prioritized on the base of usage and impact across the organization. So those were then classified in four categories. The first was those that can be maintained for a three-year period, basically ending December of this year, without really any effort or remediation required. Those that required upgrade to a newer release of the current application, those that should actually be retired and decommissioned, and then lastly, those that could potentially be repurposed. Next slide, please. So just to give some sense of the applications that were identified and addressed, those included applications in the area of public works, in human services, and in corporate services. Next slide, please. In addition to that, we then focused on our cloud application portfolio, starting with our Salesforce CRM platform, implementing standard seasonal releases on an ongoing basis. I'm really pleased to let the committee know that in 2020, due to some focused effort from the Salesforce team internally, we were able to update our platform health score from around 50% to 88%, which is rated by Salesforce as very good. Next slide, please. This slide is just for committee's reference. It gives a sense of the detail level of tracking that we currently have in place. This is a manual tracking system, but we are constantly assessing and reprioritizing our application portfolio based on urgency and age. Next slide, please. So as I mentioned, we identified initially 44 applications which required disposition. Since then, as I said, we've also continued to revisit and assess our application portfolio, and that number has now increased to 67 that we sort of currently have on our radar as higher priority. And of that 67, since 2018, we have completed 12, some of which I've referenced in the previous slides. We have another 13 in progress, and that leaves us with 42 higher priority applications that still require remediation. Next slide, please. So our approach is really a three-stage approach. We will continue with ongoing remediations of smaller scale applications. Secondly, we have already submitted a funding request for catch-up. A request to allow us to have the resources to reduce that number of 42 significantly. And we anticipate that we will be able to complete a significant portion of that 42 over the next 3 years. And our ultimate longer-term goal is to align ourselves with the corporate asset management program. So IT assets have never been included in the corporate asset management program. There is a desire both on the part of corporate asset management as well as IT to have that alignment and to allow us to have a steady state approach towards funding, identifying, tracking and reporting on our application portfolio. Next slide. Thank you, and we'll stop at this time for any questions that you may have.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Very interesting. Open it up for discussion. I see the hands up, Councillor Fonseca. For the rest of the members, if you can either go to the symbol for the headshot, just as a reminder, and put your hands up. So otherwise, I'll have to keep scrolling through all the people. So if you can do that, that'd be great. Councillor Fonseca.
Thank you there very much, Mr. Chair. Thank you very much for the presentation. I like how the how you've outlined the proposed direction with regards to budgeting smaller scale application and also the 2021-2023, the $10 million for capital work to address the current needs. I did have a question just with regards to risk consideration. So you reference outmoded applications and the training, the skill sets of regional staff required to support the older technology and also opportunities for process efficiencies are not determined. That's a risk. So what would be defined as older technology? At one point in time, older technology, you could say technology lasts for, say, 10 years or 15 years, but it seems right now older technology could even be like within a year or 2 years. So is there, in terms of the technology, basically, is this an ongoing, are we constantly going to have to train staff and or update the technology like within every year? Or I know it's referenced in the report that once we're in a sustained state, I guess there will be a yearly update, but it's hard to wrap my head around just like how what older technology is. It seems like it's changing basically every 6 months.
Thank you for the question. And through the chair, I'll respond and also ask the commissioner if he would like to add to it. So an example of older technology that's still in use at the region is actually Internet Explorer. So you wouldn't think of that necessarily, but Internet Explorer is required by some of our older applications. And although Internet Explorer is not supported as a browser by Microsoft anymore, they have Microsoft Edge, for example. We are still required to have that in use because the underlying application doesn't support it. But our goal is ultimately to remove all of those legacy sort of older technologies. And then to hopefully better answer your question, our platform strategy is really the basis for ensuring that we are not constantly in this position. So as we consolidate onto a core number of major platforms, those platforms have inherent sustainment models, such as I referenced, our Salesforce platform has ongoing releases, which then allow us to not only stay current, but also in terms of our staff, their skills remain current as well.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much. I appreciate that, and I do like how the report is laid out. So thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I don't see any other questioners.
Mr. Chair, it's Councillor Santos. Just one comment.
Okay, now I see your hand. Okay, go ahead, Councillor Santos.
Thank you so much, and thank you very much for the presentation. I just I wanted to flag that I just recently saw or have heard of an announcement from FCM in that there's a granting application open right now for asset management on infrastructure. I'm not sure whether or not some of the things being proposed in this presentation would qualify as such, but I just wanted to flag it just in case it does.
Thank you very much. Noted.
And the only comment or question that I have, Peter, or whoever can answer, is this a universal approach among municipalities, or where are we in the grand scheme of things?
So thank you for the question, and I'll respond, but I'll also ask the commissioner for his thoughts. But based on our external environmental scan, many municipalities are in the exact same position we are, and in fact, what we're proposing is probably a little ahead of other municipalities. For example, informally, we were in touch with the City of Toronto, and they're contemplating an approach like the one that we've outlined here in front of you, but that has not yet actually formally gone forward. And that was just our informal communication based on our contacts there.
And maybe I'll just add a bit to that. I agree with what Peter said. I think that it's important to note that when you're a very conglomerate type of an organization like ours, and you provide so many different services, it's common to sort of fall into this situation where you're trying to support so many different types of technologies across all of your lines of business. And so that's where we see a lot of similarities with other municipalities, as well as with the private sector, for, you know, much broader types of organizations tend to find themselves in this situation. And as Peter said, I think we're at not the leading edge, but certainly, you know, at the appropriate point in terms of proposing an approach like this.
Great. Thanks, Sean. Okay, now I see another hand, Neil Fairhead. I see your hand up. Go ahead.
Thank you, Chair. Through you, I'd like to ask a couple of questions more on the risk side. Risk was mentioned twice, both at the beginning and on slide 113. And following on Sean's comments about having a multifaceted organization, one of the key areas of risk, which I think should be included in the sustainment area, is the interfaces. You know, it's always the intersections where accidents happen. within, there's more than just NIS at the PIL, at the region level. There's also municipalities, I presume, have their own IS departments. Police probably does as well. My question through you, sir, is do we have a common methodology or organizational approach to ensuring that both sides of any of these interfaces between the applications we're sustaining here and any connections with other organizations, do we have a common way to make sure that both sides are maintaining security? That's my first question. I got a follow-up and one general point, if I may, sir.
So maybe I will jump in on that one. So thank you for the question, and through the chair. You know, there's different types of partners that we work with, and you named a few of them. Obviously, the local municipalities and the police. I would include in that group probably some of our subsidiary organizations, like our housing corporation as well. And you know, there are unique relationships with each of these. In some situations, such as the local municipalities, we don't see a lot of overlap in service delivery, but we do see some shared infrastructure, for example. You know, so we have our shared fiber optic network that we have in place. Whereas with an organization like Peel Regional Police, we actually have shared back office application functionality that we make use of. And so, you know, the mechanisms to manage those relationships and ensure, as you put it, the, you know, appropriate security in both places are somewhat different, I think, in each of those different relationships that we have. So as a general answer to your question, I'd say we do not have a common methodology for how we manage those relationships or how we ensure security is in place. It is very much a case-by-case sort of approach. But you raise an interesting question as to whether or not we could assess across that entire landscape and see where we stand vis-a-vis all of them.
Through you, Chair, may I ask, would it be appropriate as the senior level of Peel that we look into whether a common process for this security would be useful?
So through the chair, we'd be happy to spearhead such an exploration, if you will, to look at the appetite for that sort of evaluation across ourselves and some of our system partners. I'd be happy to take that forward and see what sort of uptake we could get across the group.
Chair, may I propose that?
I see that our CAO is on the line here. Janice, would you like to say a few words?
Yes, I would. Thank you, Mr. Chair, and good morning. And to the members of the Audit Committee that I have not met yet, our two citizen members, good morning. I'm Janice Baker. I am the new CAO for the Region of Peel, and I joined in October. So thank you very much for the question. And I think Sean has really hit on one of the key elements. Notwithstanding that there's a governance relationship and certainly an overlap in the customer base or client base that we have between the region and the local municipalities, for example, which I think would probably be sort of one of the more obvious relationships that we have. With the greatest of respect, I don't believe that there would be a lot of value in us undertaking sort of this broad-based examination. And I would say that for probably a couple of reasons. First and foremost, I know that at a more granular level, so at the service level, there is already a series of conversations that happen around shared technology. So Sean has referenced the public sector network, which is the fiber optic network. I know, for example, that with technology around, on-street infrastructure, whether it's traffic management, street lighting, there is already a lot of integration that's happened in those services. Once you get beyond that, I think it is important to point out that the services that are provided at the region versus those that are provided at the area municipalities are quite different. And in fact, we work very hard, or we try to, as local governments, to ensure that we don't overlap. And then I would say, when you get into some of the back office services, you know, each of the municipalities, with the exception of Caledon, which is somewhat smaller, but when you get into Brampton, Mississauga, and the region, you're dealing with quite large organizations. And really, over the years, they have each gone their own way. So, you know, Mississauga is an SAP shop. I was the CAO of Mississauga before I came to the region of Peel. And you know, we have other suppliers of that technology. And we really are separate entities. I mean, to some degree, that would be a little bit like, you know, asking the Bell to look at TELUS. I mean, there is while there's a shared geography and a shared client base, I think the value of those kinds of integration efforts really happen at the service level where there is overlap. And I feel really quite comfortable that those interfaces are happening. So I would hesitate to embark on a review. I would tell you at this point, quite frankly, our resources in the corporation are really quite stretched in the response to COVID and now the response to the demands for mass vaccination. Sean and his team are very much engaged in supporting those initiatives. And I really would be reticent to commit that we have the time to take that on. And I'm not quite convinced that there would, at the end of the day, be a lot of value in doing that. I think what I would commit to audit committee is that, you know, we have regular conversations between the key organizations, all of whom are investing in new technology, and we don't, you know, we look for those opportunities to have those interfaces happen. And I think there are some real successes that we can point to. So that would be my comment, Mr. Chair, and happy to entertain any other questions that the committee might have.
Thank you very much for that answer. I think I may not have been clear. I'm not suggesting do oversight so much as just lead any method of improving and regularizing those ad hoc conversations. So thank you very much. I shall hand back, Chair.
Councillor Starr, you're muted.
Thank you. Okay. Thanks, Neil. I think we're on the same wavelength and we're all heading towards the same goal. Yes, it is a complicated area, as indicated. I think to some of us, when you take a look at it and you just say, wow, who's putting this all together? But it is something we're working on, and glad to see that we've got a good handle on it. So thank you, Janice. I'm going to check the board once more. And I don't.
We do have Regional Chair Yanika on the board.
Okay, Chair Yanika.
Thank you, Ron. Can everyone hear me?
We can.
Very good, thank you. Well, just further to that conversation, Neil, thank you for your question, and it's marvelous because it was something I wanted to follow up with the CAO on. But you've allowed me to preface it through your comments, Neil. I'm going to use this, not analogy, a real-life situation. I was in London several years ago, and you arrive at the airport, then you buy that Oyster card, which is absolutely marvelous, and it takes you in the tube all the way downtown, and you just put money on the card. And I was telling the gentleman as I was buying my card, this is amazing and cutting-edge technology. And the gentleman behind him said, oh, it's obsolete. I go, what do you mean it's obsolete? And he goes, oh, we're already on to the next generation of card. In fact, you already have one. And I go, what do you mean I have one? He goes, I see you have your wallet there, sir. Yeah, I'm paying for. He goes, I see you have a credit card. Yeah, that's the next iteration of our system. So I came back to Mississauga and I go, here we are working on the Presto system. They have the Oyster system. Their Oyster system is our Presto system and it's obsolete. And I remember the commissioner of the day telling me, yeah, but this is just the way the technology is. It's taken us 15 years to get here to have one blended car. And follow up on the weekend, there was, I don't know if anyone's been following it, the Toronto Star is doing a piece on smart cities, specifically as it relates to Barcelona and all of the remarkable things Barcelona is doing. One of the individuals that was speaking to it, and I think it was a doctorate individual, someone with their doctoral degree from Harvard, that said, built into this system is the fact that what you are discussing today will be obsolete by the next time we get together. So for the older folks like me that aren't big on technology, that presents two conundrums. Number one, I am afraid, and I don't know if this was what the CAO is saying, but I'll say it as the old white guy, I'm afraid we're chasing all of this technology that'll be obsolete by the time I install it, but I recognize that's the nature of the beast. And then, and this is the fine point that I'm making, I'm not sure that's the end of it that concerns me. In other words, I don't necessarily want to be the technologically most innovative so that we're at the cutting edge. I don't have the hope side of the equation. I have the fear side of the equation that I don't want somebody telling me at 2 o'clock in the morning, Chair, we have a problem. They've just taken $50 million out of your reserves because someone's hacked your system. That's what scares me. So between that, and I hope there's a question in there through to the staff, I aspire to being the best that we can be, but what I want is more confidence that at the back end, the basic sort of nuts and bolts of we are as good as we can be in terms of peril, risk, et cetera, because that's more a top of mind concern for me. So, and I don't know if the city manager was speaking to that to agree. I don't want to be at the leading edge or the bleeding edge necessarily, but by God, at the tail end, I want to make sure that, don't you worry, we're ironclad. We're doing everything we can do so that the fear you're worried about as opposed to the hope is well addressed by the region of Peel. Could I have someone comment on that, please?
Janice, are you?
Yeah, through you, Mr. Chair, I'll start, and then I think Sean would probably want to weigh in on this as well. So I think you're right. There is a balance in terms of the investment in technology. The one thing I would say to you is some of the comments that you made relate to cybersecurity and, you know, the protection of our data, the protection of our systems, the training of our staff. We just actually dealt with that issue in terms of implementing additional and mandatory training for staff at our most recent executive leadership team meeting around the whole issue of cybersecurity. So I think the one thing that I would say is, you know, we will not spare effort in terms of protecting the systems that we have and ensuring that we are up to date. And that might be the subject, and certainly I've done this in the past, that might very well be a subject that we could bring to audit committee and do a briefing, although because it's a security briefing, we would wish to do that in camera. I think with respect to the investment in our systems, I mean, what we really look for is a business case. And you are looking for systems that you know, are mainstream, that can be that are routinely upgraded. You take advantage of systems change, but also process change as those are being implemented. And that's more of an iterative process. And I think that is really an area where, you know, we are starting to get our feet underneath us now as an organization in terms of having a robust plan for both the systems that we own today and the ones that we need to invest in for the future. I would say to you as an organization, I believe that we do have opportunities around digital service delivery, online service offerings, and Sean and I are starting to have those conversations. But those should be built on a strong foundation with the applications and the systems that we're investing in. And maybe I'll stop there and I'll hand it off to Sean because he can talk at a little more detailed level about some of the things that we're doing to, I think, Chair Unica, achieve the objectives that you're outlining, but also address some of the fears that you've mentioned as well.
Thanks very much, Janice. And I'd like to just add a little bit. I think you've characterized it very well. We do have opportunities with respect to improving our digital service offering, and we will certainly pursue those. But to the point of, you know, do you want to be a bleeding edge organization? I think the answer is clearly no for an organization like us. What we seek out are well-established technologies that are in place, and that there's a clear business case for how those can support the service offering that we have to our community. And those are the things that we really look to pursue. You know, in the private sector, there's more liberties taken in terms of pursuing bleeding edge technology, but in the public sector, and particularly for organizations like us, that's really not the philosophy that we ascribe to, and that's written down in our strategy documents and in the way that we cover what we call our enterprise architecture and the standards that we place on acquiring new technology. There was a question asked earlier in the session today about technology perhaps going obsolete within a year. And that certainly happens. There are examples of that sort of thing. But for the most part, that's not the world of technology that we live in. And the majority of the projects that we are currently pursuing are broad-based in nature to either, there's really two big goals that we pursue. One is to provide better digital service offerings to residents and businesses of the community. And the second one is to provide a more efficient way of doing business within our own organization. And those two goals tend to dominate the projects and the expenditures that we make on IT within the region.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that answer. And through to Janice, I really like the comment that you made. Certainly not now, it's a hectic time all around, but in the months to come, perhaps to be determined by Chair Starr, the CAO, Sean, I would love that report to come back to committee and council along the lines of what is our state of affairs as it relates to cybersecurity, best practices, whether the fall or early in the spring of next year, but just to give us a 35,000 foot feel of where we're at and give us some comfort that, you know, we're well protected. So I will leave that to you folks, but I think it would certainly be welcomed by this committee and council. Thank you.
Yeah, I think that comment is well-founded, and it's something that I think staff are well aware of, and as Janice is, and it's something that we should be following up on a regular basis. I think, Neil, you mentioned that way back in one of our meetings about our cybersecurity. Okay, I don't see anyone else on the board. Neil, are you back on?
Yes, Pete, if I may just add a sure. little comment, particularly stimulated by Chair Inica's earlier comments. I'm very much into the people and process as well as the technology side. So when we're looking at this, can we please include that? I'll just give you one little anecdote. A couple of days ago, I was reading a Wired magazine article on SolarWinds. Remember the big hack that happened in the States? It turned out that, according to Wired, I obviously don't know it directly, but according to Wired, it turned out that the password on the download server, which was being used to load all this stuff onto, I think something like 100,000 clients, the password was SolarWinds123. That is not a process which is secure. So I'd like us to also include that in any review of security. Thank you, and I'm out.
Okay, great. Thanks, Neil. I don't see anyone else on the board. Neil, would you move the receipt of the deputation and the report?
I so move.
Yeah. Seeing no other comments, all those in favor? Don't hear any objections. That is carried. On to item number 6.2, which is water meter testing, and this is again for information, but it is a presentation by Stephen Fanton and Jennifer Weinman. And I'm not sure, Jennifer, I see your name in there. Are you taking us through a presentation? Or Stephen?
Yes, I am. Thank you. Thank you, Chair Starr.
Okay, go ahead whenever you're ready.
Thank you. Good morning, Chair Starr and committee members. Steve and I are here today to provide you with the results of the water meter testing audit that was recently concluded. Also here with us this morning, I'm going to apologize. I'm going to turn off my video only because I'm having some connection issues. here with us this morning to support Steve is his manager, Al Marks. And also with us this morning are the three consultants from eSource who worked on this audit, Don Rankin, Gary Mann, and Dylan Kelly. And they are here should you have any specific questions. Next slide, please. The report highlights include that procedures and practices are in place and follow the American Water Works Association standards. And there is an active preventative maintenance program in place that includes regular testing of water meters at various intervals annually, every 4 years, depending on the size and the consumption patterns with the meters. And a large commercial meter will be retested annually as an opportunity to enhance the existing water meter practices. It's important to note that there were no points of non-adherence with the association standards noted during the audit. Next slide, please. So for the presentation this morning, I will walk you through the audit objective and the audit observations, and then Steve will join and he will talk about some of the best practices that were noted that are in place at the region, as well as the management action plan that has been implemented. And then we'll conclude the presentation and take any questions that you have. Next slide, please. In response to a request that was received from Regional Council, the Audit Division procured the services of consultants with expertise in the American Wastewater Association standards to assess the region's current water meter testing processes to determine if they were in compliance with those standards. They looked at meter testing at the point of installation of a meter, as well as during the routine testing and when there is maintenance performed on meters. Next slide, please. The processes for water meter testing are in accordance with the standards noted. And during the visual inspection component of the audit testing, the meter was found to be properly installed. And on the photo that you see on your slide, that is the meter that was tested. And the meter is on the left-hand side of the photo. And we did find an active preventative maintenance program that was in place and well documented. So now I'm going to turn over the presentation to Steve, and he will walk you through that information about the best practices and water meter testing processes that are in place.
Great.
Next slide, please.
Great. Thank you, Jennifer. Hopefully everybody can hear me okay. Over the course of the audit, the auditors noticed that there are several activities and processes that are in place that are deemed to be best industry practices that are not necessarily followed by others. In this case, for this specific audit, there were three findings, or three observations, I should say. First, for our larger water meters, which typically service commercial and multi-unit dwellings, they are tested by experienced and trained staff that have specific training for larger meters. The American Water Works Association identifies this as one of the most important aspects for commercial testing of water meters, and the region follows the standard. Secondly, when installing some of our smaller residential meters, the region always incorporates a flush test to ensure that the meter is working properly. But just for a little bit of context about what a flush test is, a flush test essentially is flushing a toilet in the home to make sure that all the water in the toilet actually passes through the meter. The reason why using a toilet is best for this test is that we know exactly how much water a toilet has, which is typically 6 liters. So it's very simple to know if 100% of that toilet water, that 6 liters, actually passes through the meter. It's actually a very simple but effective way to test a smaller residential meter. Lastly, all of the region's meters are from one manufacturer. In this case, it's Neptune, which is often not the case with other municipalities. This is deemed to be a best practice as it allows staff to develop a deeper product knowledge since only one manufacturer and understand the nuances of the product. This helps to ensure that the testing process is completed both properly and consistently every single time, So the process and accuracy levels are aligned with the American Water Works Association's. Next slide, please. Now, with every audit, there are always some learnings that are uncovered, which are important so we can find opportunities to be even better. In this case, there was one finding with the auditor, which the auditor deemed to be fairly minor. Now, periodically, in locations with larger meters, where the amount of water used during the test can support larger volumes of water flow, the audit team suggested that staff retest 1 meter annually at higher water volumes. So a little bit of context for what this means. Every time a new meter is installed, there are 5 flow tests that are completed at different speeds of water flow and different volumes of water. The total volume of water that's used through these tests is 2,500 liters. The American Water Works Association suggests 4,000 liters be used, but they also provide considerable leeway around this. So by no means is 4,000 liters set in stone. On the other hand, the hardware manufacturer, which is Neptune in this case, recommends that about 600 liters be used during testing. So by using 2,500 liters that the region uses today, we're actually using 4 times the amount of water in our testing than what the manufacturer recommends. The existing process today actually works, but the auditors recommended that staff retest 1 meter a year at the higher volumes of 4,000 liters just to validate that the original test was actually accurate. Since the completion of the audit last fall, we've actually introduced this additional step into our operating procedures. Next slide, please. And I guess back to you, Jennifer, on the conclusion.
Yes, thanks, Steve. So in conclusion, we can report that the water meter testing procedures and practices that the region has in place were found to be in accordance with those standards from the American Water Works Association, and that there were a number of best practices in place that the region is practicing. There is the preventative maintenance plan that has been mentioned, and since this slide was finished off, that has been implemented, that the large commercial meter is one is retested annually, and that first test took place in the December. Next slide, please. So that concludes the presentation from Steve and I, and we are happy to address any questions that you may have.
Okay, thank you, Jennifer. The first one I see on the board here is Harris Berry. Harris, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you for the presentation. I had a question regarding the management response on one of the observations. So the response says that a retest was scheduled to take place in December of 2020. So I wanted to check if that did indeed take place and what the results were.
Through the chair, yes, the additional test did take place in December, and it validated the findings that were done in the previous test. So there were no new surprises through the retest.
Right. Okay.
Okay. Councilor Fonseca.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for the presentation. Had a couple of questions. So with regards to testing of a large commercial meter. Where does if you take smaller size businesses, where would they fall into testing? So in the audit, it's referenced that large commercial meters, residential and multi-residential, are tested. For smaller businesses, restaurants, would they be captured under not only restaurants but also just smaller size businesses? Would they be captured under large commercial meters, or where are they captured? And that was that part of the audit?
Through the chair, I'll let the auditors kick in afterwards if they have any further comments. As part of the testing, there's two types of testing, or there's two times in which testing is completed. A, when the actual meter is installed, and we just want to make sure that once we install it, there's no defects in the actual hardware, and B, we want to make sure that it was physically installed properly. So that's whether it's a smaller residential or a small business or a large industrial type customer. The other type of testing that's done is more on the proactive side, which Jennifer alluded to before, which is where we go through our largest water meter water consumers on an annual basis. It's about 150 to 200 that we look at every year. And we actually, because they are, the dollars are very significant, we want to make sure those are functioning properly to make sure we're not over or under billing the customer. So in terms of that, that's, and then on top of that, we'll scatter around 100 random throughout the region. I believe it's about 100. So we don't necessarily look at small versus medium versus large. Large, we have that 150-ish, that we 150, 200 that we probably look at every year. And then 100 kind of random ones we look at. But 100% of all of our meters are tested once they are installed.
Okay, thank you. And one further question. With regards, it's great to see in terms of the active preventative maintenance plan being put in place. Is there a way, either through the website or through the water bill or somewhere, to ensure that business, residential, multi-residential, everyone is made aware of what the region is doing, like mostly from an education and an awareness standpoint? What seems to happen is, and I believe this actually was one of the reasons why Regional Council asked for this audit to be done, was that what happens is we get delegations after the fact where the multi-residential or the residential or the businesses are coming questioning either the maintenance of the water meter and or what they're seeing on their bill. So is there a way that we can continue, or are we continuing to update everyone that we serve? Obviously, we service everyone with water meters, a way through an FAQ or, you know, just to let them know what we are doing in terms of active preventive maintenance.
Thank you, and through the chair. Thank you, Councilor Fonseca. I think that's a great suggestion. I do believe we communicate a little bit, but I think there's more that we can do there in terms of making sure it's a bit more front and center around, without getting into a lot of the details with our residents, but just reassuring them that there are some testing procedures in place that validate that it's working properly. I think there is more, to your point, that we can do there just to satisfy that question, because to your point again, it is often the case when delegations do take place, there are questions around the proper accuracy level of our testing, the proper functionality of our meters, which is most likely not the case. But to your point, there's more we can do to communicate there. So we'll take that away.
Thank you.
Okay, just checking the board once. I don't see anyone else. Stephen, or somebody from your area, is there a way to check whether there's a leakage problem, say, from the street to the house? And I bring that up because several years ago, I had my sprinkler system leaking. I could see my meter going. And when the technician came out, he was able to determine that there was a line burst, and he was able to go right to it with some sort of a meter that he had. Do we have the ability to, if a resident, following up on Councilor Fonseca's comments, to find out whether there's actually a problem on the property?
Through the chair, I'll take the first stab, and I'll invite Al Marks to add in any commentary that I may have missed. So Councilor Starr, yes, so we are able to determine where the leak takes place. It is after the fact, not proactively. We don't have detectors in place on all of our households and businesses around water usage on a real-time basis. But after the fact, if they are noticing that their water meter is spinning a lot quicker, we can help isolate where the potential leak exists. And actually, that is one of the things that we do. I'll go on tangent for a little bit. If a customer doesn't notice a higher water bill or their meter spinning, we'll do a leak test actually on the phone first, just to give them some quick things to think about. And if we can't isolate it over the phone, either they get their own plumber or we'll bring in someone from the region to actually do a physical leak test, which includes sprinklers as well. Al, I think you're on the call. If there's anything I missed, feel free to add any additional commentary. And I think I was having some technical problems before the call, so I'm not sure if they're out.
Yes, through the chair, we do have verification reps that we would send out, and they will go through the home where the residents and look for any possible leaks and offer suggestions on how the homeowners can save on the amount of water that they are using.
That's good to know. Okay, I don't see anybody else on the board. Councillor Fonseca, would you move the deputation? Okay, all those in favor? Those opposed? None. The motion is carried, and we'll move on to the third item. And my screen blanked out, so technology. Okay, we'll move on to the third item, which I can't see. I know we do have a presentation again.
Item 6.3 is update on contract management processes for emergency shelters. It's a for information report with no presentation.
No presentation. Okay, so I'll ask the question. Are there any questions or comments on the report? Councillor Fonseca.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you very much for the updated report and the audit. I do have a few questions. So one, with regards to in what has been done, so on page, I think it's on page, implementations as a response to audit findings, I think with the fire and emergency plan, fire safety and evacuation plan, does this also include a SEPTED or a community safety plan, or was a safety audit included? So like a SEPTED. Don't know if anyone can answer that.
Not sure which party can answer. Is there a...
I apologize. Sorry. I just lost my connection at that moment when Councillor Fonseca started to speak. So I'm going to ask you if you could repeat the question. All apologies.
Yes. No problem. No problem. With regards to actions that have been completed to date, and I do want to say thank you. It, obviously, quite a few of the actions have already been updated within a very assertive timeline, so that's wonderful to see. With regards to fire safety and evacuation plan, does this also, or has this also included a SEPTED or like a community safety audit and community safety plan on site with the shelters?
So thank you for the question, Councillor Fonseca, and through the chair. No, that was not one of the components of the fire and safety plan, but I can certainly take your suggestion back because we are in the process of working on a request for proposal to go out for a new vendor, which is not to mean that Salvation Army will not be excluded from that process, but we are putting an RFP out this summer and we are updating our shelter standards.
Okay, thank you. It is a suggestion. Just my experience having the Dundas shelter in Ward 3 over the years. It's great to see the fire safety and evacuation plan, but at the same time, for just safety protection, community safety of the those that are in the shelter, but also staff and the surrounding community, having a SEPTED done, my experience is supplements or help just helps round out from a prevention and prevention standpoint and a community safety standpoint. So if that could be considered, that would be great. My next question is, so this is a, with regards to the client feedback process, and I guess a little bit in terms of overflow facilities. So this was an audit done specifically around the adult shelters. But there, and there's a brief, there's a little bit of a reference to youth shelters and transitional. But I do know that based on overflow capacity needs, some of the youth are, some of the youth have been in, have been placed in the adult shelters. Has there, with regards to the client survey, have their comments or feedback been captured, or is that going to be part of something totally different?
Just to clarify, you're talking about youth in the youth shelters?
Yes.
So we are taking the lessons learned and the best practices from this audit, and we are applying them across all of our shelters, transitional, youth, all. Yes. It will, okay. It will be implemented. In fact, I think they already have been.
Okay. And that would be with regards to revising the regional shelter standards to bring them in line with housing first principles, that would be the same. So
yes.
Not only for the, okay. Okay. That's great to see. One other question, because there is so much, and I recognize that right now the priority, obviously, there's so much going on with regards to COVID, and I recognize that that's the case. But with the number of next steps that are listed in this report, and the fact that the new contract management practices will be extended to housing services, contracts for peel outreach, youth shelters, transitional housing for spring of 2020. Is it possible, I guess, just through direction to have this brought back again, maybe in October of 2021 with another update?
Yes, we'd be happy to do that.
I'm not sure if there's any other, and I don't want to put more work on everybody's. I know there's a lot going on through COVID, but because this is such a comprehensive plan, and there are a lot of next steps that are referenced here, that would be my request if it could be brought back then.
Yes, certainly. Thank you.
And my only one other point is. Are a lot of, I know that the region has been a leader in terms of addressing through COVID best practices, and this is a little bit outside of the audit, obviously this audit, but at the same time, because of the timing with COVID, are the best practices that the region has been experiencing and been implementing through COVID, will those also be captured in the next steps in terms of the contract management process for emergency shelters?
So as I mentioned, we're currently updating the shelter standards, and we are also taking an RFP out. To market in terms of acquiring or renewing the vendor. So everything that we have learned through this audit and everything that we are learning through the isolation centers and such that we have set up during COVID are being implemented and incorporated in those shelter standards, which will form part of the RFP.
Okay, that's great. Thank you very much.
Okay, let me see here. Very good questions. Councillor Fonseca, you must have been reading my notes because I was going to suggest that we bring it back. Whether, Janice, whether it's too soon, but I would think the fourth quarter or maybe the first quarter of the following year, whatever works best for you, I think we're a little bit flexible there so that you can get some information since we're going through a lot of new processes. And I, for one, would like to see those captured and to see how we're doing with them. I know this was a, as you know, at council, this was a big concern. And so the more information we have, if we can do it in the fourth quarter, first quarter of 2020.
So thank you for that, Councillor Chair. I was actually going to suggest that perhaps we did delay it until next year for a couple of reasons. If we come back in October, we'll just be in the process of implementing the new standards. Right. And if it is certainly a priority to us, but the same staff that are working on these shelter standards and acquiring a new vendor are also the staff that are implementing the isolation centers. So we're trying to balance off that workload. So if you give us the flexibility to come back early next year, I think that would probably be more appropriate.
I think we agree, and Councillor Fonseca is giving a thumbs up to that too. Do I see any further questions or comments? Okay, Councillor St. Clair, I know you're looking at the notes very carefully. Would you like to move this report? Okay, it's been moved. All those in favor? It's carried. And the next item, I think I have, I'm back on track here. Is item number four, just to make sure, bear with me 1 second. Yes, 6.4, which is for information, the Deloitte 2020 plan. And that's here for information. Anybody's got a question, staff can answer, but otherwise I think it's pretty self-explanatory. Seeing no questions, Councillor Santos, can we receive that report for information? Are you there? Councillor Santos? No? Okay, we'll take it to Mr. Zuberi. Would you like to move that?
Sure, moved.
Okay. all those in favor. I know sometimes it's difficult on online. All those in favor, carried. Okay, we'll move on to communications. We don't have any communications. Any other business from any of the members of the committee or anyone else? I'm going to check the board here to see anybody raising their hand. I don't see anybody raising their hands. We don't have any items in camera, and the next meeting is slated for March 4th at 11 o'clock. That's a Thursday. And if that gives members of the committee, I always say this, any heartburn or there's a lot of us missing or whatever, please let us know way ahead of time. Otherwise, we'll make have a motion to adjourn. Councillor Sinclair. Councillor Fonseca, everybody's got their hands up at once. You must have other things to do. Busy morning. Have a great day, and just remember, we're going to day number 311 tomorrow. All the best. Thanks. Thanks to staff.